Welcome to Thursday morning. It's great to see. It was great to see so many of you last night and also today. So, welcome to the panel on building trust online. We want to talk about security and encryption and privacy and what some of that stuff matters to us as policymakers and technologists. So, just to begin as an intro before I introduce our panelists, we kind of sit here today as a group of people as part of one of the most significant technological advances we've made. We've been part of creating this network that's connected the globe, allowed individuals, relationships, and businesses to flourish in a way that I think no one could have imagined 50 years ago, perhaps with the exception of George Orwell. But the growth of the internet and its continual evolution kind of surprises, I think, even the most hardened cynic. Our children growing up in a world where they're always connected wherever they are, they can find out any information whenever they want, consume any global media, all from the comfort of the sofa, all without lifting a finger, all for absolutely no cost. Meanwhile, for the rest of us, we can sit and we can click and we can order products and have it delivered to our door, increasingly by automated means. We live in an incredibly changing world. But that evolution has come with a huge bunch of challenges. As in the physical world, we see online those who seek to exploit that. They exploit it for criminal means, for propaganda, and abuse. The anonymity and the ease of access and the low cost makes it very straightforward for those who wish to use the internet for foul means rather than fair to take advantage of that. Whether it's propagation of extremist views, the ability to access confidential information, or plain old cybercrime, individuals, businesses, and governments find themselves rapidly trying to tackle this threat, for which they're often very ill-equipped. Against this backdrop, law enforcement has to take action and evolve to tackle the threat. And they're busy using technology to fight technology. And this has become an arms race that's concentrated around access to data, access to monitor it, and the ability to monitor traffic, information, and patterns. Now, whilst no right-minded person in this room would wish for online crime to perpetuate, recent events such as the leaking of information by Edward Snowden show the lengths to which some governments and some administrations are prepared to go to try and protect their citizens. And that has left a lot of people very uncomfortable. Many people have sought protection through encryption of their communications. Companies such as Apple and WhatsApp have made significant publicity from their ability to encrypt their end-to-end communications. Other businesses have taken more drastic measures and taken their data centers and their network routing and taken them out of administrations where their data is likely to be looked at. So we need to get that balance right as policymakers and technologists. Everyone wants an internet that's open and free and that benefits all. We know just as in the physical world, the cyber world needs policing. We need to bring criminals to justice. We need to balance the rights of everybody, both law enforcement and individuals, to privacy and security, to make sure that we can continue to trust the internet and allow it to evolve. So this is no challenge for the faint-hearted, and certainly in this room there is no faint-hearted here. So I'm delighted to welcome the panel that we have here today, whose job it is to try and unpick some of those difficult topics. I couldn't ask for a better qualified or better bunch of people to have this discussion with. So on my left, we have Jay Daly, who's the Chief Executive of New Zealand Registry Services. Again, next to me, I have Drew Bagley, who is a Director at the Secure Domain Foundation. And over to my far left, we have Danny McPherson, who's Senior Vice President and Chief Security Officer at VeriSign. So we have a fantastic panel of people to break down this topic. So with that introduction, I'll hand over to Jay. And Jay, I wonder if you'd like to say a few words.
Thank you, Simon. Thank you for the introduction. Yeah, so my name's Jay Daly. I'm the Chief Exec of the .nz Registry. And a major priority for me, and I think a major priority for many of us, is a secure namespace. We're quite clearly in a period of market maturity and market consolidation. The heavy period of growth has gone in most cases. I mean, some countries are still experiencing it, some places. But traditionally, in any new business, you get to a stage where people decide that you really need to raise the maturity of that industry. And we're very clearly going through that phase now within the DNS and top-level domain industry. And big part of that is tidying things up and cleaning things up. You know, we want to advertise our namespaces as secure, clean places for people to have domain names, to operate, to shop, those sorts of things. So for me, I'm going to just pick out two themes. The first is about the obligations a registry has within that, about becoming a secure registry, and then what that might mean for the interaction with registrars and how you might go there. As a registry, we have regular security testing undertaken of us. And there is no alternative, in my view, to having to paying people to try to break into your systems. I love policies, I love documentation, I love risk analysis, I'll do those all day long, but if I don't pay somebody to physically try to break into my systems, whether that is across the internet, whether that is coming to the office or any other means, then I'm never going to know if I'm safe. And I would encourage anybody who doesn't do that to have that done. It is one of the... It's a very emotional moment when you get the report, and the report shows you that they have successfully broken in and stolen absolutely everything they could steal out of your company. And after a few years of doing that, when they manage to get less and less and less each time because you've blocked them and got better and better at it, you start to feel comfortable about it. And maybe after 5 or so years, you might decide to start publishing the reports about things. So now, while you can pay people to do that yourself, a big part of this is about your interrelationship with the community. We publish a vulnerability disclosure policy, sometimes known as a coordinated disclosure policy or something else. It's basically a statement to anybody in the outside world that says that if you find a vulnerability in any of our IT systems or any of our systems, you can tell us about it safely. We are not going to send, you know, helicopters full of lawyers after you if you tell us. There are some very simple rules in there, like don't damage our systems when you find it. You know, be good enough to tell us. But if you follow those simple rules, then we will work with you to fix those. And now, this sounds a bit odd, but people who find those vulnerabilities actually normally want them fixed. They normally come to you because they want to say to you, look, hey, you've got a problem here. Please fix it. It'd be nice to see you to get better. And so this policy is a very strong type of statement and commitment that we make externally that says that we'll do that. We even pay bug bounties to people who find problems. And our bug bounties range from a very high $20 up to a really, really high $200. So it's not an expensive thing to do to pay people for bug bounties. It's great. There are other policies you can look at there as well. A big one that's being developed now through many companies in New Zealand is a transparency policy. That's where you publish details of what governmental requests you have had for data, whether that's from the police, whether that's from other form of law enforcement agencies, not you know the actual details of them, but the numbers in categories, and you let people understand how their private data is being shared through the judicial process as a result. And it gives people a better understanding of what takes place. You can also develop that policy to include things such as how you secure the data, how you encrypt it and things. So that's the first part about a secure registry. The second part then is, now, how do we then export some of that to our registrar community? What do we expect of registrars? Do we need to set them policies that says to a registrar, you must have this form of external security testing done every year, or you must publish this type of policy, or you must do this? And it's a difficult balance there, because on the one hand, this is a competitive advantage to some registrars if they're advertising they're a particularly secure and safe registrar, and at the same time we want to raise the level of the entire registrar market by putting those standards in place. There are some TLDs that the registry pays for a security test of all of the their registrars. So .au do that, for example. It's just another way of doing things. So that's a complicated matter, but it's certainly one that I think that we are probably a bit far behind beginning to think about as the expectations that we should be placing on registrars. And the final point then about dealing with registrars, as well as the compulsion side through policies, is how do we partner with them? And for me, the main channel for doing that at the moment is the sharing of threat intelligence data. That is, so For example, we receive data feeds from Shadow Server, the Anti-Phishing Working Group, and from OpenFish, which are lists of domain names within .nz, and then details of whether they are compromised sites, they're hosting malware, or they're hosting phishing, or this sort of stuff. And we provide that to our registrars, so that our registrars can begin to understand what the nature of their contribution, in a bad way, to a secure namespace is. And they begin to understand that if they were to do something about that, this is how that would tidy up the namespace. Now that's a, and there's no compulsion behind that. That is simply provided as a psychological nudge to them, for them to understand that this is a an issue for them. And this idea of threat intelligence sharing, I think, is a is going to grow and grow significantly. And they're quite clear that policy is lagging about this. You know, for us to properly root out some of the issues we need that exist, we need to share data with a variety of partners, not just registrars. And many of our policies are designed to prevent sharing of data or inappropriate sharing of data without actually having specific allowances for sharing it for, you know, with particular types of trusted parties. So we need a development of that. So those are my three things there. We, you know, the big priority here is a safe and secure namespace. Registries have a role to play themselves in doing that. And then we have some real questions about how we should be working with our registrars to make registrars do that as well.
Great. Thanks, Jay. Drew, do you want to talk?
I think the last part of where that Jay discussed is a perfect lead-in for what I'm going to discuss. So I help run the Secure Domain Foundation, which is a nonprofit that's dedicated to empowering internet infrastructure providers such as registries, registrars, and hosting companies to combat cybercrime through the form of DNS abuse. And so what we do is we get registrars, registries, and hosting companies to share the threat intelligence that Jay just described with us. So we get the lists of domain names that are known to have been used for phishing, for malware hosting, command and control botnets, or the high volume spam that's usually linked to cybercrime. And then we have years and years worth of historical Whois data, and we have an API that correlates all of that. And we're actually able to profile the bad guys, because even if they're using bogus information, they're still using the same bogus information over and over again in order to scale. And so over the past decade and a half, cyber criminals have successfully scaled their operations. Whereas because of some of the constraints that Jay mentioned, it's much more difficult for those who are trying to stop cybercrime to scale back. And so, some of the issues that we run into is we'll run into providers who aren't comfortable with sharing data, even though the only data we need is the data of the sites, the domain names already taken down. And so usually we're able to talk through those issues, but you get a lot of people, I think, throwing up the privacy flag in a way that perhaps it's not intended for, because it's not necessarily privacy you're protecting if it was fake information used and it was a person who violated your terms, and then on the flip side, a provider's going to protect every single little tidbit about them to the degree. On the flip side, what's very complicated is you have cyber criminals who will use real people's identities, and those identities shouldn't be out there and need to be protected. And so this whole privacy discussion, as it relates to security, really becomes very gray and murky in this DNS space, where I think all of us are still trying to figure out the best ways to share as much data as possible without even taking a chance that we're that anyone's violating the privacy rights of a real, actual individual. And so along those lines, what makes things even more difficult with the ways in which cyber criminals will abuse the DNS is that a cyber criminal will register a domain name, use a privacy and proxy service that they'll hide the registration behind, and maybe they'll register that domain name with a reseller, and maybe it's a reseller that accepts Bitcoin as payment instead of credit card. And so you have layers and layers of anonymity. And so if everything works and the domain name was taken down right away and no one was harmed, maybe that would be one thing. But instead, what you see is you see, because of these layers of complexity and secrecy, you see these things living much longer than they should and harming people, and that there's more victims because of how difficult it is to either get the out of ICANN's reach or out of a ccTLD's reach privacy and proxy provider to help out, or even a reseller to stop selling domain names to knowingly suspicious people with knowingly suspicious indicators as far as the email address they're using or their IP address. But you in addition to that, you're just getting a situation in which you have, whether intended or not, layers that are adding time for the cyber criminal and protecting the cyber criminal. And these are the prime areas where, when you're talking about cyber criminal scaling, the traditional methods of waiting for law enforcement to get involved when law enforcement is completely overwhelmed just really don't work in such a rapid world where money is lost instantaneously and the victims add up. And so exactly what Jay described, I think that's the model going forward, is internet infrastructure providers really taking action to share data when they can, to have good policies in place so that they're protecting their customers, but not bending over backwards to protect someone who is victimizing other people who may in fact even be their customers. And I think entities such as Shadow Servers, such as the Secure Domain Foundation, APWG, I think going forward, the world of trusted nonprofits is going to be one of the best conduits through which you're going to see competitors sharing information that helps everyone and benefits the entire ecosystem. And so those are my opening thoughts.
Thanks, Tree. Danny.
So, I think I pretty much agree with everything that's been said thus far. I believe that some of what Jay hit on is sort of where I was going to start and then pivot a bit, is that I think that, the DNS sort of most user and machine desired transactions on the internet today begin with a DNS transaction, right? And so if you're an adversary and you want to sort of manipulate a target or intercept something or perform some nefarious action, then the DNS is a great place to start. It's also what makes the internet global, and it's also a inherently multi-tenant. And so, interestingly enough, anytime that you attack some component of that, either for eavesdropping or for visibility or intercept or whatever, there's a lot of opportunity for either causing denial of service or causing some kind of collateral damage to other tenants on that infrastructure. And so, one of the things certainly is the availability of the infrastructure is a big component. And then, the integrity of the responses that you get out of that system. So, certainly DNSSEC, for example, brings integrity and authentication capabilities to the DNS, but it also brings a lot of complexity to the DNS. And, ironically enough, somewhere, but perhaps even in order of magnitude, more complexity to the system. My day job is a CSO, VeriSign, and there's not a lot that I do that makes life easier for anyone. And so it's usually like, here's why you can't do this, or here's how we're going to help you do this more securely. And it doesn't make most things any cheaper or more efficient. It's usually more controls and capabilities, and a lot of compliance-driven stuff. The compliance-driven stuff that I hate, I mentioned some of the numbers for it. I think currently we have about six compliance frameworks we're capped to, which is 672 unique controls that we have to do just to be in compliance with what we said we're going to do, including some of the root and .gov operations and Sarbanes-Oxley and other things that we have to do to protect information. And ironically enough, a lot of the compliance stuff is to solve problems from 10 years ago, right? And by the time it gets codified and it's captured somewhere where we have to, have to subscribe to that to be able to operate and say sort of, here's a height limit to be able to operate this piece of infrastructure, provide this capability, then, that's sort of where we end up with, is this big chunk of stuff that we have to do. I think according to IDC, 83% of IT security spend is for regulatory compliance and that sort of thing. And then you do things to protect, like indicator sharing and other things, to better fortify your infrastructure from currently known threats. And so spend a lot of time checking boxes, and you know, quite frankly, you know, it makes good sense, because anytime we have a problem, we go back and say, what sustainable capability can we put in place to make sure that problem doesn't happen again? And we spend a lot of time with that, and then you end up with all these check boxes, of course, and then you say, well, I need to put this fire out or deal with an immediate threat versus something that occurred in the past. So, you know, to be more preventative in that. You know, I think that one of the interesting things with the DNS in particular is that, you know, the availability and integrity of the system matter an immense amount, right? You want to get the right answers and in a deterministic way, no matter where you're at, you know, in the world. And so, you know, how is it that that occurs in the DNS today? And so that's something that, you know, from a global multi-tenant platform perspective, that, you know, that's why the DNS is so successful and why it's so important today in sort of the security landscape and the privacy landscape that we have. I think the, you know, there's sort of a constant tussle with security and privacy, right? Because you know, we want to be very surgical and be able to squelch malicious activity from various types of adversaries. And to do that, you have to have context and baselines for various types of behavior. But at the same time, you want to make sure that that you preserve privacy for users of that system, right? Or they're not going to trust that system or want to share their information with that system. And so, the fact that again, that the DNS is used so broadly across the world makes it a high value target for adversaries, right? And so things we can do to build people's trust in that infrastructure, the availability, the integrity of it's really important, and certainly to preserve the privacy of what occurs on that infrastructure is really important. One of the things, I guess, to key off what both Jay and Drew hit on is, you know, one of my hot buttons recently is indicator sharing, right? You know, information sharing and legislation and all the things that are happening around that. Ironically enough, you know, a lot of people want to share information, but there's not sort of a broad notion of provenance associated with that information. And if you don't have that, then what you end up with is things that look like, you know, a TSA no-fly list from 20 years ago, where it's like, how do you get your indicator back out of that system when that system's been cleaned, right? You know, a broad array of the assets out there that are used for malicious activity, in particular some of the nouns that ICANN cares about, like IP addresses and domain names, are oftentimes resources or assets from compromised users or victims themselves. And so the problem is that when it finds its way onto this indicator list or it's shared, right, or somebody wants to enrich it and pass it on, there's no feedback loop when the system's clean. And so, you know, basically with a lot of scorched earth, right? I mean, my high-end firewalls of VeriSign, you know, provide 250,000, maybe a million entries for being able to block various stuff like IP addresses or network prefixes or domain names or whatever. And, you know, and yet, you know, most of my vendors have somewhere between 50 and 100 million unique pieces of malcode, or, you know, or my spam list may have a couple of or tens of millions of domain names in them, right, or phishing lists, that kind of thing. And so the problem is pulling stuff back out of that system in an efficient manner once they've been sanitized is really important. And I think that, you know, from both a privacy and a global availability perspective of that, you know, we want that hygiene in the namespace or in the number space to occur, and you know, for those feedback loops to exist. I think that everybody's all about sharing information now, not necessarily maintaining or providing feedback loops in that. And I think that that's where some of the challenges will arise as we get, you know, get more effective or efficient at doing that. So I don't know, a few things to key off what they said, but kick it back to you, Simon, for whatever whatever you want to go now.
Thank you. That's great. There's a huge array of topics to tackle there, and what I'd like to do is try and unpick some of those. And actually, I want to unpick some of the difficult stuff in some of those topics. I'm happy to ask some questions, but I would love some questions from the floor as well. So please do feel free to chip into the debate. I know Paul's got a microphone if you want to. Christian, I just want to kick off with, firstly, just to get things going on a slightly controversial topic, because I think that's where we need to head. I want to go back to something Jay mentioned, which is when I first joined the industry 7 years ago, I was amazed by how much information sharing there was. I came from a very commercial world where everything was kept secret. I came into a registry world where everybody shared everything. Those days have changed dramatically, and even those of us on this panel find ourselves being both friends and competitors, and we're competing for the same business. So we have a desire to share data, but at the same stage don't want to appear vulnerable to people that we might be actually pitching for business for, particularly as we change in the world of GTLD space, even VeriSign now taking part in that race too, apparently. And so consequently, how do we balance that need for data sharing and information sharing, but also remaining commercially competitive businesses?
Well, I think this, I'll go back to the part of the point I made at the beginning of this. We're at a transition point in our market globally. We need to seize control of our market a little bit more. For many years, we have not had to do much, and domain names have sold themselves. Let's be honest about it. I don't think there have been some great marketing geniuses in the domain name world for anywhere. It just happened. And we've got to a stage in the last year or two where we now need to put some effort into it. It's not going to sell it entirely by itself. I think we all recognize that we need to work together to lift this industry. We need to take control of it in some ways. And one of the elements of taking control is to secure it and clean it and tighten it up. So that means things such as eliminating bad quality registrars. It means things such as eliminating as much phishing and malware distribution through domain names as possible. And so long as we bear that in mind, then I think we all know that if we do achieve that goal, it's going to help us as an industry, help us all financially, and I think that's a good enough motivation for us to share and work together.
So, and I think the sharing of threat intelligence through domains is one thing. How about that kind of disclosure of security issues that you talked about? You know, that kind of open and honest, actually we were hacked and this is how we were hacked, so that other businesses can learn from that and tighten up their security. How do we balance that need?
So, yeah, I can pile on. Actually, one of the things that we do, you know, one of the components we have in one of our businesses is something known as iDefense, and we use that internally. I'm a customer of that product or service, and one of the things that we do with that is we track all registrar, compromises, breaches, the campaigns by adversaries from Mad Lead to Lizard Squad to whoever, you know, whoever it is that has various campaigns against these sort of, you know, components of the infrastructure, and what are the vulnerabilities or exploited in what manner, what were the motivations for the adversary to attack those targets, right? And certainly this applies sort of cloud and other internet infrastructure services as well. And then we say, all right, well, you know, we tabletop that and say this is how it applies to our infrastructure and our operations, and here's how we can improve or fortify our own security posture to make sure that we can deal with those kinds of threats. Now, one of those things is certainly sharing of various indicators themselves, and another is, you know, good hygiene and operations from patch management to, you know, authentication controls, whatever the various things may be that are being exploited, right? Including, you know, security awareness and phishing exercises and all that basic blocking and tackling stuff that most organizations have to do today. We share some of that information, and we occasionally publish things broadly, and certainly iDefense has their customer base, and we consume it. We share some things certainly with our partners at ICANN and so forth as well. I do think, and you know, to your new GTLD point, right? We have a 170 or so back-end registry strings that are, you know, that we operate, so that's a big chunk of the new GTLD space. And one of the things for me across the board for both enterprises and, you know, from national security emergency preparedness for the U.S. government to critical infrastructure sectors, you know, across the board is that I think it is kind of a shame in, you know, in this day and age that if there's a vulnerability and somebody has the capability within their observation space to say, here's what occurred in, you know, to this enterprise, that shouldn't happen to anybody else if you're sharing information effectively, unless it's sort of at real time when it occurs. And so if you can share, you know, sort of exploit, you know, tactics or techniques that are employed by someone and allow your partners or others in the industry to fortify, certainly our partners, the registries, you know, other registries, registrars and so forth to make sure that they can mitigate that threat if they have the capability to mitigate the threat. Now, certainly, you know, as we've all seen, you know, with nation-state adversaries, the sophistication and capabilities they have are very, very high, and, you know, and most of the people in this room have some piece of infrastructure that they probably care about, and there's probably someone whose day job is compromising your infrastructure, which concerns you a lot, right? It certainly concerns me. It keeps me up, but so I think that the better job we can do sharing infrastructure, sharing indicators and threat intelligence is important. I also think that as part of those programs, as sort of ICANN in particular with relation to the DNS, continues to mature, providing some high-level abstractions, if not real-time threat intelligence, at least sort of here are the general themes and primary vulnerabilities, and they're going to be just like the ones that occur with big enterprise in the U.S., like phishing and exploits and patch management or whatever the issues are. But you know, those sort of best practices to registry operators and registrars are really important. I know that SAC does a lot of those kinds of things in their advisories as well, but there's sort of no force for people to consume those things, or that says you must consume and apply these in that manner. I mean, the penetration testing stuff that Jay talked about is a great example, right? Where that's kind of thing. It's like, hey, that's kind of what good looks like and what you ought to do. But you know, there's a broad spectrum of resources and capabilities to various people in the ecosystem that allow them to do a really good job at that, or to not do that at all. So I don't know. I think I'll pass.
So building off of the experience of the actual infrastructure providers. At the Secure Domain Foundation, we've actually really seen a true business case for being proactive about anti-abuse and for sharing information, because not only at the registry level and keeping your zone clean, but going down to the registrar level, it really costs so much money to deal with this stuff after the fact because of the human resources involved when you're fielding abuse complaints and fielding a support desk, following up with some complaints that might not be valid, and trying to parse those out from the ones that are valid, and then responding to perhaps even law enforcement requests if something gets that serious. And so I think when you look at that and you look at those costs, I think that alone is really an incentive to really cooperate, even as Simon said, with competitors and among competitors. And so obviously, you have to understand that business case and how that affects your bottom line to buy into that. But that's what we've seen. And so we did a survey last year of several registrars, and we found that the time and the cost spent on this stuff definitely cost much more than it would have had they just been doing simple steps from the get-go, as far as sharing these malicious indicator lists and actually even querying would-be registrants. So when somebody goes to register a domain name, check real quick to see if that exact email address, the IP address they're coming from, the registrant data they're using has been associated with a known phishing site or a known malware hosting site or whatnot. But as has been mentioned, you don't want to end up with a situation like, 20-year-old no-fly list or something terrible like that. So whatever indicators that are shared, there should be a feedback loop, and they should at least decay over time, right? Something that was bad 2 years ago is likely not going to be bad today. But as long as you are using that information to even flag things and follow up on things, and use intelligence in a way that you're going to manually follow up on, I think there's a lot of business savings at the end for that. And so, I think that even if competitors aren't able to share directly with each other, I think it's through trusted third parties that you're going to start seeing a lot more of this information sharing.
Gotcha, yeah. Thank you. James, sorry, I know you had a question, and it's taking a while to get to you. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. It started off with, I think, Jay, and then was echoed a little bit by Danny and yourself. So with two country codes and VeriSign on the table, I have to ask, you're talking a lot about sharing information, indicators, and threats with your registrars. But as we know, the bar to becoming a registrar is low and getting lower as we try to encourage competition and development in other regions. And particularly if the registrar is collaborating with or might even be a bad actor themselves or aligned with some sort of a state actor. My question is, how are you vetting registrars in particular to be recipients of your indicator and threat sharing? And do you share with all of them on an equal basis, or do you have to develop some kind of a track record with them before you let them in on the other side of the curtain?
I think that's much easier for me to answer than anybody else, because we certainly don't have a low bar for entry to become a registrar. The security and stability of the .nz namespace is an important part of the determination of who can become a registrar. And so it's easy for me. I don't have to differentiate in that sharing. I do agree with you, though, that you have to have some form of reputational feedback loop in this. If I am sharing threat intelligence with registrars, and over a period of time I see natural differentiation with some registrars acting on that and other registrars not acting on that, then that will drive different behaviour with those who act differently from me, certainly. I'll trust them more, or I'll potentially provide other data. Now, provided that we set a clear path to that, that shows any registrar, if you follow this path, you can reach another tier of data access effectively, then I think that's an honest, you know, way of doing it. It can be done like that. So I'm not necessarily convinced by the inevitability of the way you introduced your question, that the bar is lowering and will continue to lower. Personally, I think we ought to be looking at the bar raising over time, as we expect the professionalism of registrars to go upwards, because the whole industry needs to get more professional.
Yeah, so, yeah, the only thing I would probably add, yeah, I think I agree with a lot of that. It's a little different from our perspective in that most of the accreditation function comes through, you know, ICANN from that perspective, as opposed to the CC side, to his point, I think. But most of the active threat intelligence we share, if we share something, is in a very targeted manner to a specific registrar. If we have that information, either associated with their activity in our registration systems or other things within our observation space. And then participation in lots of trust groups that, you know, I know that some of you folks participate in as well. And then, you know, one of the things that's interesting too, I think we're seeing an evolution of, you know, where the critical infrastructure sectors, for at least for the U.S. government, like the ISACs, as they're known, information sharing and analysis centers, and then the evolution of that to sort of less rigid definitions like ISALs, like information sharing analysis organizations. I think that, you know, there are various aspects of those across sort of the ecosystem, and some exist today with critical infrastructure operations, some exist in you know, in CCTLD or in some of the GTLD registry and other areas. And I think that you know, some more formulation around, you know, sort of operational security with you know, specific to DNS is good, but I also think that most of the vulnerabilities and other things are and even threat intel that are shared there are shared in other internet security operation spaces where most of the folks in this room, or at least if you operate infrastructure, have had the opportunity to exist. And I'm not sure we need something specific there, but I think that you want to be able to provide as much information to vetted parties as possible and then let them apply that in their operational environment. So
I think from a nominate perspective, we probably sit somewhere between the two. We have our own accreditation of registrars. We see, particularly this year for us, is going to be a big push about sharing threat intelligence. And actually, one of the things we see is I think Jay's point about feedback loop is really important, which is as we share information, those that act on it get rewarded. We want to make it commercially good for registrars to act on threat intelligence, you know, whether that's access to more data, access to more services, or potentially even preferential pricing as a result of good security behavior. And so I think we see that, but we see it very much as a kind of carrot approach rather than a stick approach so it's a combination, if that makes sense, of that accreditation and getting over a certain bar, but also the behaviors once you're over that bar are really important to us. Drew, can I ask you to step back to your former life? And Drew used to work for the FBI prior to the SDF, and try and be act as law enforcement for us on this panel. How would law enforcement view this debate, do you feel, and what would be their input into that the topic of information sharing?
So speaking with my disclaimer that these are my own views,
of course,
no one else's. I think the challenges faced by law enforcement are actually a bit similar to some of the challenges I discussed from my perspective as being, you know, a private actor who's working in the cybersecurity space. And so for law enforcement, I think that, you know, when you're talking about the DNS, when they are working on a case, there still is this need for expediency, and the processes in place often don't lend to that, especially when you're dealing with, you know, the international threat landscape that is the DNS. And so I think for law enforcement, you know, one of the difficulties I often hear is that they will have, you know, maybe a registrar who is, you know, not very cooperative. It's come back to me with a warrant and whatnot, and meanwhile, people are still being victimized. On the flip side, that, you know, is the process in place. And so I think what then adds even more of a layer is if you had, for example, let's say U.S. law enforcement, you had the FBI, and they were working a case and Americans were being victimized, but the registrar in question that they needed information from was located elsewhere. And to complicate things more, let's say it's in a country with which the United States does not have a mutual law enforcement assistance treaty with. Well, then you're running into so many layers of complexity where it's not complex for the cyber criminal to reach that victim here in the States, but it's very complex on the flip side for our law enforcement to protect our citizens in that situation. And so, I know from my conversations with law enforcement officials from all around the world that ICANN, that every country is running into this in these different scenarios. And so, you know, I think part of that is that the cyber criminals don't have to operate by the laws and work within these restrictions. Law enforcement do, and you know, for the most part, really do it well. But there still is that time gap. And so I think that, that's why you see such a strong law enforcement presence with like the public safety working group now in the GAC at ICANN. And you see there being these new forums or new fora that, you know, didn't previously need to exist before the internet to try to solve some of these problems and cooperate. But, you know, I don't know if the answer would be updated, modernized treaty regimes, quicker MLAP processes, or what? But those are some of the difficulties.
I mean, picking up on that topic, and both you and Danny particularly talked about, which is that kind of complexity and that kind of we have a system which we need to keep running and make sure it's very stable. At the same stage, we're adding in security complexity in order to try and tackle some of these threats. Do you think law enforcement plays enough of a role inside the technical communities, not just the kind of policy and enforcement communities, but actually inside the technical communities to create an ecosystem that allows that dissemination of information and actually ease of tackling that criminal behavior? Do you think there's enough presence in those communities?
You know, I can't speak to whether or not there's enough presence overall. There may be or may not be, but I think one frustration with the private sector is that the information flow is not two ways, right? So generally law enforcement wants this threat actor data for good reason to stop cyber criminals. But then the organizations, the private sector organizations, the nonprofit organizations that in some ways are actually perhaps even more on the front lines with the cybercrime fight aren't able to get data back from law enforcement around the world and from different organizations when law enforcement is discovering a threat or whatnot. And so, part of that, I know from as far as reasons that at least are articulated, whether they're you know, valid or not, part of the reason is, of course, that you get into weird complexities over liability, because what if they pass along information that is used by the private sector? It turns out that it was a mistake, it was wrong, hurt someone's business and whatnot. I think the governments don't want to do that, get in that business and be responsible for that. I think, of course, depending on the country, but often in Western democracies, some form of Freedom of Information Acts will come up where there's restrictions on what information can be shared and whatnot. And then I think also there's investigations that could be hampered if certain information is shared too soon. But I know that that's definitely a friction between the technical community trying to stop the bad guys and do the right thing, and then the law enforcement that also has a shared goal.
Gotcha, yeah. Thank you. Just before I go on to you, Danny, I've just got a couple of questions queued up. So.
Oh, yeah. We can go on. I'll speak to that.
Great. Okay, sure.
Thank you. So, Jim Galvin from Affilius. It's interesting, the discussion we're just having is a nice segue into the question that I wanted to ask. So I know this is the DNS forum, and we're very focused on the DNS, you know, technology, the infrastructure. But I wonder if we could broaden this a little bit. And I have two things that are sort of behind this one question that I want to ask, and I'll say what those are. I'm really interested in what is the role of or your relationship with policy and legislation. And I want to emphasize I'm talking about legislation here, not regulation. I want to explicitly exclude that from the discussion. And I have two things on my mind. One is in talking about law enforcement, there's a lot of focus here on the voluntary participation in order to make a better place, right? Make a safer and more trustworthy, you know, online internet. But we're not talking a lot about capture. You know, so we're not talking a lot about how do I get rid of the bad guys. Here we're just shutting them down. You know, I mean, we're just talking about the things we're going to do to make it stop happening. But, you know, how do I keep it from happening the next time? You know, so that's sort of one of the things that's behind my question about the role of policy and things like that. And the second thing is just this business of it being voluntary. You know, I mean, it's nice. Jay was talking about the accreditation process that they have for registrars. And I like James over here talking about how it's a race to the bottom in registrars in the GTOD market in many ways. I mean, I hate to use that phrase, but it does apply in many contexts. I mean, how do we raise the bar more generally? You know, I mean, that would be, in my mind, the role of policy and in legislation, because you're trying to stop it the next time. It's not just about this time around. So, thank you.
Who wants to pick that one up?
I'll respond to some of that, I think. I think one side of it is, I certainly agree with you know, the aspects of attribution and, you know, it's nice to see when people get arrested for various types of malicious activity or takedowns of, you know, organized criminal activities, that kind of thing. And so we certainly contribute to that where possible, you know, certainly following the law and have a lot of interaction there. I think we also see we're seeing more and more law enforcement and policy engagement in technical discussions to understand the capabilities, right? Like, you know, I'm one of the folks that pushed back really early on to some of the COICA and SOPA and other types of, you know, takedowns in the DNS in particular, because you're not really dealing with the consumer or the producer or distributor of goods. You're dealing with the mechanism that helps you rendezvous and discover where it's actually located. And so I kind of used to liken that to, you know, taking a drug dealer's phone number out of the phone book. It's really not going to have an impact on, you know, on the efficacy of drug distribution on the street, right? And so I think, you know, at the same time, it has an immediate impact, and it lessens the asymmetry that exists in sort of, you know, in cybercrime today, right, which is a big part of the problem. So I think that, you know, the asymmetric capabilities for adversaries where, you know, they take one step and do what they want, and then I have all this backlog of process and laws and legalities and multi-lat team agreements and all these things that I have to deal with to be able to respond to that one action, right? And so it's certainly very asymmetric. On the information sharing side, that's another example, like with the recent CISA legislation where, to Drew's point, a lot of this is, here's how we pave the road for you to share with the government, not the inverse, right? And so it's like, well, how about you help me out, right? And you know, that's sort of my private sector argument from that perspective. I think that's one side. Another side of this where, you know, I know that, for example, Bobby Flame was going to be on the panel from the FBI, and he spent a lot of time on, and this is something even the SAC at ICANN has discussed with, what's a stable identifier on the internet today? Can I associate an IP address or a domain name with an individual in some manner? And more, even those are becoming multi-tenant. And so, you know, how do I have the information that I need to be able to attribute something so that somebody can get a door kicked in or send a missile or whatever it is they want to do, but at the same time preserve people's privacy for the good folks on the internet? And I think that's sort of, you know, at the heart of this constant tussle between privacy and security on the internet today. And, you know, that's the more informed, for us, our general perspective of VeriSign is the more informed policymakers and regulators and other folks are, then the better off we're going to be. And I think that there's certainly lots and lots of interest. And, you know, if anything, folks want to move too quickly in some areas. But, you know, certainly we, you know, I mean, that's the reason we participate in a lot of these kinds of forums, is to make sure that folks are more informed so that, you know, less badness comes of compliance or new controls or laws that we're captive to. So,
I don't know. Can I respond to that, actually, and a question to the panel back, which is, you know, something we experienced at Nominate was we would work quite closely with law enforcement with takedown activity, particularly around fake goods and everything else. We found ourselves trying to act as partly as a kind of clearinghouse for some of that information and say, actually, rather than just taking it on word, actually checking some of it. And actually what we found was sometimes we were being asked to take out legitimate sites, you know, asked to take, and as soon as you start to do that, actually that erodes trust in that process very, very quickly. Right? I wondered whether you have experience, any of you have got experience of that kind of working closely with law enforcement to deal with some of these issues, but managing that process to make sure it's safe as well as quick. If that makes sense.
Yeah, go ahead, Jay, first, then I'll.
Well, okay, I'll answer that, but at the same time answering Jim's question. I think it was only a few years ago that we talked about things being in terms of internet years, because there was a very different speed of evolution within our industry compared to the real world, it appeared. We don't talk about that so much anymore because the real world has begun to catch up a bit and has begun to evolve a little bit faster. And what I see certainly is that law enforcement and the, in a very broad term, because there are multiple agencies now within there, are evolving quickly. So just within the New Zealand context, we have a police force, they have a cybercrime unit, there is a national cert in the process of being set up, there are spam compliance units, there are other compliance units, there are several agencies now with legal, legislative powers in place for them to act and for them to to be responsible for the capture of criminals and the dealing with criminals in that way. And this has happened just in 5 years' time or something. It's happened very, very quickly. And so for many years, I think we were a bit of an outlier in our industry because we could see these problems, we could act on it, we had the data, and the rest of the world was still talking about letters interrogatory, which is the way that a court in one country sends something to a court in another country and, you know, has to go with a case of champagne or something, you know, in order to get it read. And so we're beginning to see the real world and the legal side of things catching up and doing things better. And I think that's important because I really don't think it's our job to be involved in the capture of these type of people at all. I think it really is our job to stop them at the borders, push them away, keep them out, but it's someone else's job to then deal with them, you know, prevent them or to deal with them at that point. And finally, the rest of the world is catching up on that, and that's very useful for us.
Yeah, I think the key here is that you have to do what you're best equipped to do. And so for internet infrastructure providers, they are equipped and should be proactive about anti-abuse. If I'm a bad guy at hotmail.com keeps registering a domain name, phishing domain names over and over again, maybe you at least make him change his email address to I'm a bad guy too at hotmail.com before he can register a domain name again. And so you look for, you build that detection of suspicious indicators into your process so that you're taking a hands-on approach from the start. To the question about putting the bad guys away, I think a lot of, probably it sounds like all of us up here would like that at the end of the day. But to the extent that internet infrastructure providers can stop the crime from happening while still ensuring the internet is free and useful for everyone else, that should be the primary role. And then I think this, that question as far as putting the bad guys away, that's a policy discussion for everyone keeping their own backyard clean. So here in the States, maybe that's, and we have increased resources in recent years, but that's something where we can only do the best we can with the treaties we have with other countries and what's within our borders. And I think with each country, there's that. And so this is something that needs to keep being raised, I think, at the international level with heads of state. And so I know we've seen that from the US perspective where President Obama has been raising these issues. And I think cybercrime needs to be elevated to that level because any other crime over time that became some sort of international phenomena eventually was. And so that's where I think you need to start seeing perhaps at an international level, countries putting pressure on each other to take care of their own space and clean it up. But that's not necessarily a role for the private sector. And I just wanted to add one more thing that makes this stuff difficult is, for internet infrastructure providers, how do you stop cybercrime before it happens when you see that someone has registered paypal.com, and they used one for the L, and you know it's going to be used for something bad, but it hasn't been used for something bad yet. And I think that's such a gray area, and that's what creates a lot of issues, where there's just cybercrime in the making, and it's very hard to stop before it happens.
Could I just real quickly respond to that? Yeah, so I think certainly homographic attacks, that sort of thing, either with or without IDNs, which makes it even far, far worse, but are an example of a place where some controls are in place, but I think that there's some policy work and other things to be done there as well. I do think that both technical deterrent controls, like the examples you gave with Hotmail, are a great example of things that people could do things smarter to sort of, you know, move that asymmetry bar up a little, is one side. And I also wanted to agree with, the deterrent controls where attribution exists, so I don't have to put sort of reactive controls in place and arrest someone, but instead it's like, look, you know, there's some level of attribution on the infrastructure and you will be held accountable for your action, just like you are in meat space, right? Or in, you know, cyberspace versus sort of the real world. And so I think that the more that capability exists, but again, that's sort of at the heart of balancing sort of the security and attribution with people having anonymity and privacy on the internet, right? And so that's sort of the really hard, tussle there that we got to deal with. And I think that we certainly need that to have a trustworthy infrastructure and more deterrent controls to be able to prevent this, so that people, you know, can't do anything they want on the infrastructure. They realize that a cyber attack does have real world consequences. And so I think finding that balance is a really tough spot for policy and law enforcement and whatnot.
Gotcha, yeah. Thank you, Paul. I think we've got another question at the back there.
So hello, Patrick Feldstrom. I work for NetNode, but I'm also chair of ESSEC. Really good discussion. Thank you very much. And you're saying really good things, but I would like to add a few things. Of course, a lot of people in the room know me, so I, of course, need to add things. Anyways, the first thing I think to be able to move forward in this kind of discussion, I think it's important to separate the discussion about what to do during an event, how to prevent an accident, who is involved in actually dealing with something while it's happening, and how you build the feedback loop of, for example, that you had weaknesses in your system that led to the ability for the system to actually have the issues, so that the management of the feedback loop and stuff is something completely different than actual actions during an event. In the old days, we could send in the military, police, or whatever during an accident. In the internet world, we need to have things installed already when things happen, which means that taking over responsibilities during the event, for example, to law enforcement from an ISP is just not working. Whoever is doing things when the weather is nice also have to take care of things during an incident. So the first thing, I think, is to separate the two. The second thing is that what we really talk about is trust. Because what you are saying, all of you, I think, to phrase it differently, is that for someone to disclose vulnerabilities or whatever, you need to trust whoever you are giving the information to, that the information is not misused, or like, because everything is built upon market economy and blah, 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 all of those kind of things. Unfortunately, on the internet, it's still the case that trust very much is built as trust between individuals and not trust between organizations. And one of the things that I claim that we are trying to do is to bridge the trust between individuals to become trust between organizations. Okay? But that's a difficult gap, and I really one day would like to see serious discussions on how to be able to build that. Because between organizations, you have contracts, you have all different kind of things, and like, who are you going to share the information with? And the most important thing regarding trust is that I have never seen any good example of a third party forcing someone who to trust. Forcing someone who to trust is extremely difficult, specifically to force an organization to trust another organization. Like, never mind. So the only way to get an organization, which we don't have trust between organizations, we're between individuals, blah, blah, remember that? So to get an organization to disclose vulnerabilities to some other organization that they might not trust, I don't see that happening by legislation. You cannot force anyone to do that. Instead, whoever is to receive the information, as I think it was you, Dan, or many of you agreed to it at least, there must be an incentive for someone to give the information away. And that means that whoever claims to be a cert cannot say, I am a cert, and because of that, you should give the information to me. That will never happen. People will lie. They will not tell the whole truth. Instead, whoever wants to be a cert, or whatever you call it, they need to start by defining a product that they produce based on the information they get. And then, given that the market, and I explicitly use that term, believe that the product is important, then other parties will share information with the organization that they need to be able to produce the product. Okay. So for example, we have a cert in Sweden for many, many years. No one gives the cert any information. Okay? So just having the organization doesn't really work. So why? Because the cert is part of the regulator. Who that is under regulation will have interest of actually giving information about vulnerabilities that might be used to tell them, I'm sorry, you now have to pay a fine. So at least in Sweden, we have, just let me take an example here. We have something for trains and airplanes and shipping. We have something called the Swedish Accident Investigation Authority that is investigating incidents as part of the feedback loop, not part of the events themselves. And they say themselves, the purpose of the investigations is to clarify as far as possible the sequence of events and their causes, as well as damages and other consequences. And then a little bit more words. But then really, really important. And this is what I have been fighting for 20 years in Sweden to get, and so far I failed. But anyways, I still think it's the right thing. The sole purpose of this agency's operation is to improve safety. The authority has no inspection remit, nor is it any part of its task to deal with issues of blame, liability, damages, or matters of certification, disciplinary measures, etc. This means that such matters are neither investigated nor discussed in connection with investigations. I think that is the only way to move forward, that we start to do IT-related investigations in that way that we already do.
Thank you, Patrick. So, there are a couple of bits in what you said there that I've actually looked at through local trust groups and try to create an evidential basis for understanding them. So the first one is about sharing data with certs, specifically about sharing data with certs and then within further trust groups. The evidence that we see is that, yes, there needs to be a product, but that's actually the second problem. The first problem that needs to be resolved is absolute clarity around the what will happen to data that is shared. It is perfectly possible for somebody to be a regulator and receive data and not use it for the regulatory side of things if they have an extremely clear policy that says that that's what they will do and that you can disclose it to us. This goes back to the point that I made at the very beginning. We have a published vulnerability disclosure policy, which basically says to people, in shorthand, you're welcome to try to hack us as long as you don't break anything and tell us about it, and we may pay you. It's a very, very clear statement along those lines. So the evidence that I have from surveying within New Zealand is that there are plenty of people willing to share their data with a cert without any need to see what the product is for a couple of years at least, provided that they have absolute clarity about how they can share that and what will happen about sharing that data with them. So the second part then is actually, again, comes very strongly from evidence, but is entirely counterintuitive. Organizations are most willing to share within industry verticals. So telecommunications companies are most willing to share with other telecommunication companies. Lawyer firms are most willing to share with other law firms. Now, that seems counterintuitive because those are competitors, very clearly competitors. But what, just in attempting to unpick the evidence that we have about this, is that people understand how those other companies work because they're the same as them. They have movement of individuals between those companies. They have common goals. They have common processes. There is so much similar from one telecommunications company to another telecommunications company that they feel very confident about sharing that information. So there's already a lot of information sharing going, which I, beyond the level that I expected to find when surveying this, within these industry verticals. So the first trick is, how do we formalize that a bit better by putting policies in place that makes that better, that drives that? And then the second trick, which I have no idea how to do, is how do we then bridge those industry verticals so that the information is shared across them? But it is actually happening, and no matter how counterintuitive that may seem.
Picking up on Patrick's point actually about trust and how do you force it? You know, there's this small organisation known as the European Union, which we've accidentally dropped out of as Great Britain, who were very much, they were very much pushing towards mandatory disclosure. So actually making it part of legislation that you had to disclose security incidents, you had to share data. And I wonder what the rest of the panel's view is on finding yourself being forced by your own law enforcement to hand over information.
I would just say real quickly is that it certainly has a way of moving the needle. I think, you know, as you saw, I think if people lost data in California initially, I believe was the first data loss regulations, then you had to disclose it unless it was encrypted. And so all these people sprung up that provide disk encryption capabilities, and enterprises started doing that, right? And so I think it certainly has a way of moving the needle. I think that breach disclosure or various types of disclosure laws vary widely, even within the U.S., much less outside of that. And so I think to that specific point that it certainly has a way of moving the needle and for legal folk at least.
To your question, I think these data breach notification laws, I think that the key is having a uniform data breach notification law, and then it can be a great thing, because then you would have, then even if I have to disclose when I have a breach, so do my competitors, and then you probably have a safer ecosystem. I think what's complicated is when you have the patchwork system like we've had in the States with 50 different states, and where, California had a data breach notification law before everyone else, but then that didn't mean Ohio did and whatnot. And so I think that's where you get into very tricky situations where the incentives aren't all there maybe to do the right thing and inform the public. Similarly, I know in the States, part of this has been baked into the rules and regulations for our publicly traded companies. And so, I think going forward with all of these new things coming up with the GDPR and the European Union, I think you could potentially have some positive outcomes if it truly harmonizes things. But as I'm sure you know, with some of these preliminary analyses about it, it looks like it might, even though there'll be all these robust things built in, it still looks like it could be implemented very differently amongst the member states. And so I think that's kind of a wait and see. And real quick, just to chime into Patrick's point about building up, how do you build sustainable trust amongst organizations? So I can't speak directly to certs, but I know in our own experience with the Secure Domain Foundation, that's absolutely what we're seeking to do, is to build something that's sustainable and kind of taking this whole trust group model where you know the individuals and then turning that into an actual, sustainable model going forward. And so for us, we are a nonprofit. We're not attached to the government at all. We're actually Canadian-based. And we are, member-driven. And so I think for us, what our path has been is we're getting members that are sharing only the minimum amount necessary to do something great. And so that alone is kind of building the trust, because you're lining up the interests, and we're building something where the more people who share, the more it benefits everyone with these malicious indicators and whatnot. And so, and then from there, that's how these relationships are built, and you kind of get the trust spread. And so I think even, going forward, if the people at the different organizations change because there is an actual benefit that everyone's getting, I think that's a sustainable model. And so I think the key there is perhaps to do information sharing in whatever realm in a very specific, narrowly focused way to accomplish a common goal. And as long as everyone's rallying around that common goal and sharing in just the way possible to accomplish that, I think you're able to sustain trust a lot longer than if you're saying, give me everything and just trust me. I think that those are two different approaches.
Thanks. I know we've got a couple more questions from the back, I think.
Yeah, thank you, Simon. It's Paul Diaz. We actually have a question from online, so read into the panel and just get to it. Danny, I think it was initially addressed to you, but actually, I'm sure all the panelists will have a view. The question is, Bruce Schneier has recently written to research indicating that there's some calibrating and probing attacks on internet infrastructure that have been going on for quite some time now. And it's suspected it's state actor-led probing efforts. Question is this a new trend? Is this an expansion on some long-term policies or trends? And then importantly for us, how should the internet infrastructure providers react to this?
So I saw what he wrote, and I think it's a fine observation. I think those things have occurred for a long time. I mean, I know a number of folks in the room of network operations experience. I've worked for ISPs and infrastructure operators for 20 plus years, and we've always seen people testing your capabilities. And to think that state actors weren't doing that would surprise me. So that's all I'll say.
I think from speaking from non experience, one of the things that we know and we found very important in tackling some of this is digging right deep into your DNS data. I think there were days where you could watch DNS data kind of sail by, and as long as your servers were green, life was good. But I think actually we have to take responsibility and dig much deeper into understanding the intelligence. And actually the footprints left inside the DNS are very important for helping tackle some of that. And we've seen, certainly inside .UK, we've seen probing, particularly not so much state-sponsored, but we've certainly seen it where people probing against companies they're about to attack. We can see the kind of patterns of abuse, and we can see them trying things out, and we can use that potentially to work together as a community to try and block some of this stuff. And I think that's really important.
Yeah, if I could add to that, I think just about every country in the world has a Department of Defense or Ministry of Defense or something else. The word defense gives away their job there. These people are increasingly stepping up their cyber capabilities. They have the specific people that we pay as citizens to defend our country against external attacks and from state-sponsored actors. I think it is quite natural for us to be talking to those people. They are the source of expertise about state-sponsored attacks. They are, it's their prime responsibility, and bring them into the loop, use them. It is, but why would we do anything else?
I think if I could say one other thing to this, and it sort of speaks to some of the stuff we talked about on the panel, is that I think if you operate any sort of thing that interacts directly with the ICANN ecosystem, for example, or the number resource organization, from a routing system component to a root or a TLD operation, or you're a large registrar, then there are certainly people whose stated day job is to learn how to infiltrate and compromise your infrastructure. And they come to work every day, and that's what they do. And so, if you think that's not the case, and you operate in those areas, then you should certainly reconsider, your vulnerability and attack surface, and and the security and stability of your infrastructure. Right. So, to Jay's point,
there's another question from the back, actually.
So, Warren Kumari, a lot of this discussion, especially about information sharing, etc., assumes that everybody wants to do the right thing. Unfortunately, the cost of doing the right thing is often a lot higher than the cost of not doing the right thing. Sort of standard example of this is there's a fairly well-known case of a registrar who mainly sells to bad folk. ICANN compliance eventually hunted them down and said, a lot of your WHOIS records are not correct, deal with that. And so they dealt with it by turning on private registrations for everyone. Obviously, that was a lot cheaper than actually fixing the problem, and it also saved their customer base. How can we fix the incentives so that there is actually a better, you can make more money by doing the right thing than not?
Right, Warren, I think that's actually a meta answer is needed for that. The problem there is ICANN, clearly ICANN, okay? And our response to that has to be to take control of our own industry and take that control away from ICANN. And in particular, at the visionary principled level of what we want to achieve with our industry, that we want a safe and secure industry. And we need to stand up together, say that together, and then from that, push down into ICANN so that ICANN then reforms its compliance measures, reforms its own policies about registrars, raises the bar for registrars, to talk about James's point about lowering the bar, and starts dealing with these people properly. Many of us have applied pressure over the last few years on the compliance bit, and we now actually have some compliance being done by the compliance people. It's great. It's nice to see that happening. But I think many of us have got a vision of where that should be that is quite different. And the best way for us to achieve that vision is for us to own it and tell ICANN.
Any other thoughts on the panel? I certainly go back to the point that I made a little earlier. Is I think we see that as, I think there are a number of ways of pushing that pressure, but I think one of them is actually showing leadership and thought leadership. And I think actually showing, we look very much about should we take a stick approach to, a carrot or stick, should we take the stick approach to kind of bad registrar behavior, where we have got bad registrar. That is one, it will fix some of the worst cases, but actually if you really want to move the needle, it's got to be about carrot and it's got to be commercial. And the trick, I think, as the industry is to make this into commercially smart to be more secure and to be safer. And that's going to have to be a joint act between registries and registrars to make that happen. And we're going to have to create frameworks and pricing and models that make it actually better business to be more secure. And I think that will really change the needle, because then suddenly it doesn't make sense to be insecure. It doesn't make sense to deal with bad actors.
And I would just add to that, I think something else is, I think there needs to be more groups doing publishing data on these types of things on a larger scale, so that you get a comparative analysis of which registrars are associated with this type of behavior, which ones aren't. And I think that would help inform policy. So everything isn't always anecdotal. So if you actually have empirical data to work with, I think that would help the community much more put pressure, whether it's on ICANN, whether it's on a specific registry to clean up their zone or whatever it is. I think that would help a lot. And so that's something I know my organization's attempting to do. And something else, I want to give a plug, because I think today is the deadline. For people interested in these types of things, there is an ICANN review team that they are accepting applications for. I don't know if it's 11:59 Eastern Standard Time that the applications are accepted until today, but I know they're due today, to be on the SSR2 review team that will be looking at many of these issues related to the security and stability of the DNS. And so I think that's great if anyone who has an expertise wants to apply for that.
Jim, let me go quick.
Thank you. Jim Galvin again from Afilius. Jay, I really want to agree with you, but I wanted to tease apart one thing that you said into two parts. And that is, you were talking about blaming everything on ICANN in terms of what's going on. And I wanted to switch that a little bit. There are certainly issues with ICANN compliance behavior, and that's its own problem, and those activities there. But I think it really is about us as a community, right? I mean, ICANN represents a multi-stakeholder environment. The compliance department, in principle, is supposed to be acting on the policies that we create for ourselves and the requirements that we set to ourselves. So if we don't like, what those policies are and what they are, the obligation is really on us to drive to fix those things. And then, the compliance part, the actual acting on what those policies and requirements are, is a separate problem. But again, it falls to us as a community to reach up to them and fix that. So thank you.
Thanks. So we've got about 9 minutes left on the panel. I don't want to waste the opportunity that we've got a bunch of techies sitting here, so I want to ask a difficult question. Sorry, guys. have we made the, particularly when we look at validation and we look at encryption, are we putting in a bunch of technology that makes the internet so brittle that we're in danger of, in trying to solve some of these problems, and I look at DNSSEC and I look at some of the stuff coming down the pipeline with Dane and other things, are we in danger of making an internet that actually becomes so brittle people stop trusting it because it just stops working?
I'll go first, I guess. I'm certainly one that, you know, I think there's a pendulum between availability and integrity. And, you know, with DNSSEC, for example, you know, we're swinging to the integrity side, and you add a lot of brittleness anytime you do that. You give less ways to get the right answer, more ways for things to break, right? More, and I mean, DNS used to be fire and forget, right? You could build your zone and push the information out there, and it was out there. And now with DNSSEC, if I can't update the information in my zone files every X number of hours or days, then it fails hard, because otherwise it would be a downgrade attack in a cryptographic system, right? And so so I think that that certainly, you know, cryptography and math has stood the test of time. I think that we've also seen that, you know, the backdoors and the implementations are riddled with vulnerabilities themselves. And so, you know, there's some components of that 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 are still vulnerable. I do think that they solve some problems, but I think that, you know, just like with DNS, you know, DNS security is far, far more than DNSSEC, right? It's everything that we've all talked about, right? It's not just the cryptographic extensions. It's everything from, you know, your availability and disaster recovery and continuity and, you know, incident response and consequence management and all those other aspects of the operation. So I think that, I think we do need to be careful about sort of over-pivoting. Just because you sign something or encrypt something doesn't make it secure. And so, you know, all the other aspects of your controls to protect that information or make it available need to be considered as well. I mean, that's sort of my perspective.
So I'm not actually a techie, I'm an attorney. So I have an excuse to not give as detailed an answer to this question. But, you know, so I can't discuss, you know, I can't really weigh in on how brittle or whatnot it is. But I could say that from a... yeah, like maybe a policy requirement standpoint, we definitely don't want to make things very cumbersome. We want to make things as automated as possible with information sharing and whatnot, so that when you are, you know, doing registrations or doing takedowns on the other end, things are going as quickly as possible. But I know that we don't want to build an internet in which there are no human decisions as to what should be, what's bad, what's good, to the point that everything's so fully automated that we are essentially breaking the internet as we know it because of, you know, blacklisting really taking over and being an automated thing. And so so that's a concern I know I have.
I think that's a great question, Simon. I think we're lucky in that we didn't introduce too much or any really encryption early on in the development of the internet. And so because we are quite clearly going through a rapid learning cycle about how to introduce it at internet scale, DNSSEC has been a fascinating progress, or, you know, project almost, the way to describe it, where entirely new concepts about how you use the keys have been created and about how you develop and how those things work. And I think that similar things now need to happen at, or are happening in other areas. We're seeing a change of the certificate authority model through DANE. We're going to see introduction of security in different ways in new models, and I think we'll have that evolve quite quickly. And I think if we didn't have that speed of evolution, yes, it would be very brittle. I'm sure that some people will introduce things in a way that are brittle, and that some of the existing uses of cryptography, if they are scaled out too big, will become brittle. But I think we're going to avoid it, luckily, because we're so late in the day doing this.
Gotcha. Thank you. Got time for one more question. I think, James, you want to hop in? Yeah.
Thanks, Simon. And I wanted to actually circle back to something Jay said a few moments ago about ICANN and their role, particularly compliance and kind of cleaning up the industry. I just want to maybe disagree a little bit. You know, ICANN and ICANN compliance can certainly, we can give them more sticks and they can go out and whack the bad guy registrars. But you know, we're very engaged. We have mature people and processes to deal with some of these threats and some of these security issues. We send people to ICANN, the SSAC, and all these other groups. That's expensive. That is a burden that smaller registrars maybe cannot bear. And at the same time, we heard yesterday, there is a push in some regions to say, what are we doing to encourage more registrars, smaller registrars in underserved regions of the world? So I do believe these are at odds a little bit here, where you're saying we need to lower the bar, we need to lower the barriers of entry to some of these smaller bars. We have to consider that security expertise and capabilities are one of those barriers to entry for some of these registrars. And so this is kind of an economic tug of war between we want the security, but I think to Danny's point, we want more availability in some regions. Unfortunately, there might be some overlap in some of those regions where also where we'd see some of this insecure or even criminal behavior.
Okay, one more question at the back.
Good morning, Russell Howarth from Nomina. We've talked very much about DNS in the context of registrars. Looking somewhat further into the future, I'd just be interested in some thoughts from the panel on how the security and DNS will start to evolve as IoT evolves and the millions of devices that will be on the internet. And moving on from the discussion around the registrars, but I think the overall wave of IoT and the devices are going to be connected. How do the panel feel as though that needs to be addressed via DNS and security and encryption?
Yeah, that's something that definitely keeps me up at night thinking about that, the onslaught of IoT devices that will be in all of our homes. And so I think that's something where you're actually going to have to see a lot more involvement, and I think you already are from ISPs, because they're going to be the first line of defense as far as what type of traffic is coming out of homes or businesses. And so I think probably going forward, that's where, and I'm thinking mostly in the botnet scenario, right, where you have all this processing power in your home, and it's all being used for something like that. So I think that's where you're going to have some very weird customer service calls where a cable operator calls a customer to say, I think your refrigerator is doing something bad. It'll be like the old, is your refrigerator running, terrible joke. And so I think you're really gonna see a lot more involvement there, even if that is calling out to the namespace. But granted, I think a lot of it would work similar to today, where you can sinkhole a domain name and see what's going on when you're talking about a botnet. And so I think there's still gonna be a huge role to play for internet infrastructure providers. The difference is it's not gonna be, let me go navigate my web browser to check out this domain. Instead, you're just gonna have to be a little more sophisticated in the ways in which you're checking out reports of abuse.
I just say briefly, I think that, it's sort of, just like the internet substrate, the DNS is, enabling things we never envisioned initially, and it's going to, volume and opportunity, and certainly introduces new attack surfaces as well. And so I think it's sort of a victim of its own success, and the capabilities that the DNS provides for global reachability across sort of this multitude of networks is a good thing for anyone in internet infrastructure space, I believe. But I certainly believe that, with that new information leakage, disclosure attacks, and certainly other types of attack surface are going to exist that didn't exist before, and, secure, stable operations and the availability of the infrastructure are going to matter even more. And so I think it's certainly privacy as well. And so I think it's going to be ever more important in that new, in that new context.
So, thanks, Danny. Yeah, but I'm aware I just want to close on time, so I'm going to leave the last word to Jay on that
one. Okay. All right, one brief thing if you want to close. I don't think we are yet certain that domain names will be the identifiers for Internet of Things. I think we have a long way to go to see. I mean, we sort of almost assume it in our industry, but I'm not sure that the developers of IoT devices assume anything yet, so we need to see how that goes. I think we have a tremendous experience scientifically in dealing with large-scale distributed systems, and we're going to have to use the techniques that come from that in order to manage these type of things. So we're not going to be, necessarily looking at individual devices. We'll be looking almost like how do a flock of birds work, and looking at IoT in that type of way, and using those sort of that sort of science to understand and mitigate threats that come through IoT.
Great. Thank you. And with that, I think we'll close the panel and try and finish on time. Can I just say thank you very much to my panelists, and thank you for all the great questions we've had. I hope it's been a useful debate, so please give up your hands to the panelists. Thank you.